want to ask you a question, if it's true or not, that the first paper you published or you presented for publication on the Higgs mechanism was refused publication.
The work in 1964 took place over a very, very short time span. I'd previously, in the year, I'd gone down with hepatitis, fortunately only hepatitis A, but it keeps you out of action for about 6 weeks. So I was off teaching. In the summer term, I was back to teaching. By late June, I'd finished my teaching duties and my examining, and I was ready to get down to some research again. My position in the research group, the theory research group at Edinburgh, was that I was the person who was in charge of the departmental library, where the collection of teaching, you know, textbooks for students, but also journals for the theoreticians who were working there. So the university library was still scattered. I mean, nowadays they centralise everything. They won't let things go to individual departments. But in those days, I was responsible for receiving the weekly consignment of the new numbers of our journals, and putting them out on shelves for the rest of the group to read. So I got to read them first. I read a paper by Walter Gilbert, who had been a theoretical physicist working with Geoffrey Goldstone in Cambridge, but who had lately been converting himself to a molecular biologist, for which he got a Nobel Prize for chemistry. And Walter Gilbert had put what looked like the finishing touch to the proof that the program, which had been started around 1959 by Yokiro Nambu at the University of Chicago to explain broken symmetries as spontaneously broken in particle physics, the thing which was holding up that program was that it predicted massless so-called Goldstone scalars, and Gilbert put what seemed to be the last touch to the proof. And when I read that, I got angry, because it meant that I'd been wasting the last 3 years of my life trying to get around that result, and it had just been a waste of time. And then I went home for the weekend, and while I was at home, I started thinking of something else I had read, and it was papers by Julian Schwinger with the title Gauge Invariance and Mass. And Julian Schwinger had already shown in those papers that if you simply looked at in technical terms, the Feynman propagators for gauge particles, then there was no necessity for them to be massless. And he had speculated that this might happen as a result of a threshold in the strength of the coupling constant, that beyond a certain threshold, the behavior suddenly changed. But I then got to thinking about that representation, and I just went home after the weekend away. I went back to my desk, and I just tried something out. I thought, well, what would happen if I drove symmetry breaking by coupling a charged scalar to electromagnetism? and bingo, I generated the spin one mass. The reason I could do that with confidence is that I had learned more about gauge invariance than most people, ultimately from a paper in 1960, in the very first page of the Journal of Mathematical Physics by Bruno Tumino, originally from Rome, but by then he'd become an American citizen. He'd explored how gauge invariance should be formulated in quantum field theory extremely thoroughly. It was essentially blighted by what Enrico Fermi had done in handling gauge invariance in electrodynamics back in about 1930-something. Fermi simply got it wrong. He mutilated the theory and everybody else thought it was okay, but it wasn't okay. So I was just lucky to have read all these different things, and it all came together.
So why was your first paper refused publication?
The first paper was the first paper that I sent to Physics Letters, whose editor was at CERN, Jacques Prentke, was simply a paper pointing out the error in Gilbert's argument, which they published. But when I actually produced the abelian model, which it was just a sort of toy field theory to show what it actually did, for some reason I shared an office with Ewan Squires, who was about to move to Durham University, and Ewan spent that summer at CERN, so he was at CERN when these manuscripts arrived, and he said afterwards he thought that perhaps Prentke had just passed it along the theoretical corridor and it had got into the wrong hands, because the recommendation was send it back and advise him to work his ideas out in more detail and submit a paper to Il Nuovo Cimento, and I was insulted by that, particularly when I later discovered from my friend Stanley Desser at Brandeis that Il Nuovo Cimento didn't have refereeing. So at that point, I amended the paper. I simply added extra material, including the remark that there would be leftover massive spin zero particle to look for, and giving a few examples of non-abelian symmetry breaking. And because I had sort of lost confidence in the refereeing at CERN, I sent it across the Atlantic to Physical Review Letters, where it was accepted. But the referee wrote a comment saying the author might like to comment on the work of Brout and Englert, which was just on the point of publication. And I later, when I finally met Nambu in 1984, I think, it was a long time, I discovered that he had been the referee. Not only was he the referee and therefore knew, he spoke the same language about this as I did, but he ought to have done it himself. But my impression that I got from talking to him then was that he had been really knocked back by a serious illness of one of his children at the time, so much so that he didn't pursue the line of research that he was doing. But he was aware that the models that he had been studying and published about did not include the long-range force of electromagnetism or electromagnetic type forces, and it was something which ought to be put right. And I think if he'd not had this illness in the family, I would still be unknown, because he would have done it. So I think Number is really the man who is the father of all this.
So I think this has been an absolutely fascinating discussion. We kept you waiting a long time. It was not easy to get to build the LHC.
Well, having been kept in touch with the problems that have to be overcome, I got a regular update from CERN about what was happening as far as confidentiality would allow, and in this I was much more fortunate than the people in Brussels, who didn't have a friendly experimental group involved in CERN to tell them what was going on. So they I think, well, of course Braut had died unfortunately a year previously. I think Englert was completely taken by surprise when it happened.
Yes, I remember in the famous seminar of 2012, you made a wonderful remark that is now inscribed on a T-shirt, which said, I can't remember exactly, but you said, I never thought it would happen in my lifetime.
Well, that was at the beginning, of course, yes. But as time went on and the machines were built and the gap got narrower and narrower, it was plain to me from the time that LEP was shut down and the LHC started, that it was going to happen and I might live long enough. But on the other hand, in the run-up to the announcement, I had regular updates about the progress from the experimentalists. In fact, the news that it might be on its way within a year or so came to me in July 2011. This is a connection with a neighbour who lives in the next street to me, and he's died since then, but he's actually a Scottish law lord. He'd retired, but he had a particle physicist's son, Bill Murray.
Oh yes,
and. So I was at home one evening, a little before the conference which was to happen in Grenoble, and the telephone rang and the voice said, "This is Jane Murray. Bill asks me to tell you that something interesting is going to be announced on Monday. He can't say what it is, but he thinks you would be interested in it."
Fortunately, you were there at the time. So I think the LHC will now continue it. It makes one collision in 1,000,000,000 makes a Higgs boson. The Higgs factory, it will be a several percent, so it'll be orders of magnitude more.
Yep.
in precision.
Yep. Well, I mean, really. That should settle the question of what else there is. Well, I hope so.
Okay.
Because I'm also interested in gravity, and I would like to see some sort of unification work.
Yes,
and I don't know what's going wrong at the moment.
Okay. Well, this has been absolutely fascinating, I must say. So thank you very, very much for giving us your time.
Well,
thank you very much.
Thank you for the invitation.
Not a very big audience, but you deserve it. Fantastic, Peter.